Yo, what's up, Tab? Hey, fam, this is the day the Lord has made. We shall rejoice and be glad in it. Shout out to y'all showing up week in and week out as we have been one church in many locations, in person and online. Shout out to all of y'all who week in and week out online, wherever you are at. Maybe you're in California right now. Maybe you're in Texas. Maybe you're in Ohio. Maybe you're just right around the corner. We're thankful that you showed up and make Tab Global what it is. Shout out to y'all and just the amazing, amazing way you make this church the best type of church it can be. We are in our second week. We're back into of April. We're back in our Unity series. Shout out to y'all just constantly showing up for resurrection. I'm still on that resurrection high from the experiences that we had. We are excited, excited, excited about what's going on in the life of our church, especially as we are back in our Unity series. In this moment, more than ever, we need a unified church, because a unified church is a powerful church, and we need power more than ever. All right, worship team, we're excited, we're excited, we're excited. If it's your first time here, hold on. If it's your first time here, let us know. We're going to show you some love. I'll be in the comment chat with you just to make you just feeling at home, make you feel at home here at Tab Global. All right, worship team, take it away.
What's going on, Tab? Our fam, it's time to give God some praise. Come on.
My life belongs to you, say. Hey.
Come on, y'all, mine.
My life belongs to you.
Nobody?
Nobody like you, Lord. My life is yours. You are the great I am, the Lord of Lords. Holy One, mighty are the works of yours.
Nobody.
Mine.
Send that up to the Lord.
Yeah.
Great and mighty is our God.
Come on, y'all, send it up to the Lord.
Great and mighty is our God.
Come on, if you know you serve a great and mighty God, come on, Tab I Fam. I tell you to send it up wherever you are. There's nobody like you, Lord.
Great and mighty.
Your name is greater. Your name is strong. God, you are higher than any other. Your name is healing. Awesome in power. On, if that is your testimony, that great and mighty is your God, that is a good place to keep praising the Lord. Oh, come on, if that is your testimony, you should Shabbat the Lord in the building on today. If you are joining us globally, if you will go with us in worship and prayer. Oh, God, thank you for being great and mighty in our lives. The Bible says, who is this King of glory? He is the Lord strong and mighty, the Lord mighty in battle. Who is this King of glory? He is our host. Who is this King of glory? He is our Savior. Who is this King of glory? He is mighty and great. Oh God, on today we come, Lord, in the tabernacle to worship you and to bless your holy name. For God, you are great and mighty in our lives. God, you are greater than any situation. And we say, thank you, God. God, you are greater than anything that the enemy throws up against us. And God, we say, thank you, Lord. God, you are greater than depression. And God, we say, thank you, Lord God. God, you are greater than our battles. And God, we say, thank you, Lord God. When the enemy comes, God, up like you come and you and like a flood, God, and you lift up a standard against us. God, you are mighty in our lives, and we just want to uplift your name and praise you on today. We thank you, Father God, that even though that the weapons form, because you are a mighty God, God, they do not prosper, Lord. Father God, we thank you, Lord God, that anything that comes up against us, God, that you lift up a standard, that you are there to fight every single battle that we have. God, you have been a Abimelech in the time of trouble. Thank you, Father God. You have been a bridge over troubled water. And we just want to say thank you, God. We come into the building on today to worship you, to praise your holy name, because you are great and you are a mighty God. Thank you, God, for being the lover of our souls on today. Thank you, Father God, for being our Redeemer. Thank you, God, for being our Savior. Thank you, God, for being God. Lord, we lift up our pastor on today. We pray, God, that you will continually bless him as he pours out to your people on today. I pray for each and every person that is in this building and those that are watching us online. I'm praying now that you would dispatch your angels, God, to be great and mighty in their situations, great and mighty in their lives. God, we thank you on today. We love you, we honor you, and we adore you. It's in the matchless, mighty name of your Son, Jesus the Christ, that we pray and ask these blessings. If you agree with the prayer, why don't you say amen, amen, and amen. You may be seated. If you will keep your attention focused on the screen, we do have a welcome video for you.
Our day just got brighter because you are here. Welcome to the most impactful place on the planet, the historic Tabernacle Baptist Church. Led by Reverend Dr. Charles E. Goodman Jr., whom we affectionately call PG, Tabernacle is a multi-generational local church making a global impact. From our youngest to oldest, and from our nearest to the farthest Tab Global family, we want you all to feel at home with us. Throughout each worship experience, sing along with our worship team as we give God glory during high praise and shout or type amen in the comments if you're online, as each sermon ministered is sure to enhance your Bible knowledge, increase your faith, and help you navigate as we do life together. We also want to connect with you, so if this is your first or second time worshiping with us, please scan our QR code to receive additional information about Tab Life.
And once again, welcome to the most impactful place on the planet, Tabernacle Baptist Church. Now, if you're part of our in-person worship, let us stand together. And if you're part of our global worship, let us recite together our welcome litany.
We are a worshiping, witnessing, and welcoming congregation. We are partners in the body of Christ, committed to making an impact through Tabernacle Baptist Church. We are committed to loving, leading, and living like Jesus by being an ally to those oppressed and comforting to those in trouble. We strive to be changed people who change the world. Again, thank you for meeting us here. Come on, Tab family, let's worship.
Oh, come on, changed people. Can you make some noise for Jesus? Hallelujah. So excited to have each and every one of you to join us on today. If you are worshiping with us online, we definitely want to welcome you. If this is your first or second time, we're going to ask you to drop that emoji in the chat, and our global family is going to welcome you in as well. Also, if you're celebrating anything, we want to celebrate that with you. Why don't you drop that as well so that we can congratulate and celebrate with you as well. In person, can we give some praise for those that are worshiping with us online? Amen. This is the day that the Lord hath made, and we shall rejoice and be glad in it. Do we have any first or second time guests worshiping with us on today? If so, if you will stand, just so we can acknowledge you as well. Any first, second time? We have some people in the building, all over the building. Tabernacle, can we show some love? If you're in the balcony, we can't see you, but we welcome you as well. We thank you for coming to worship with us. We hope this is a great experience for you and that you will come and worship with us again. Tab, one more time, can we bless those that are worshiping with us? Amen. Anybody celebrating a birthday on this week? Any birthdays this week? All right. Happy birthday. Happy birthday. Happy birthday. What about any anniversaries? Anybody celebrating anniversaries? Well, okay. Happy anniversary. Happy anniversary. Amen, amen. Everybody just excited about life. We made it through spring break. Can we bless the Lord for that? Amen, amen. Remember on last week for spring break, we took a college road trip. Again, we want to thank you for all of your donations. We were able to go to Oglethorpe College, Savannah State, and I think Fort Valley as well. What a great time that we had. So again, thank you, Tabernacle, for all of your donations. Our children were able to go and experience just a little bit of college life. So we definitely want to make sure that any student that is willing to go to college, they get that experience just to see what it looks like. Is that all right, Tab, that we did a great thing for that? Can we bless God one more time? Amen. Talking about things around Tabernacle, can you focus your attention to the screen and let's see what's going on in the life of Tabernacle?
As we celebrate 17 years with our beloved pastor, Reverend Dr. Charles E. Goodman Jr., we have a PG-17 weekend of events that you don't want to miss, Tab family. The lineup begins with our kickoff worship service on Thursday, April 25th. Reverend Dr. Philip Pointer will be here to bring us a word at our Tab West campus and online. Then on Friday, April 26th, come have fun with us at our PG-17 house party celebration at the Old Government House on Telfair Street. Fun begins at 7 p.m. and we know ain't no party like a Tabernacle party. RSVP at tbcaugusta.org.
On Saturday, April 27th, we want you to show love across the CSRA community through Purple Project Volunteerism. Sign up to participate at tbcaugusta.org. Let's show the world that TAB cares. Finally, get ready, TAB family. We're closing the weekend like we always do for Pastor's anniversary by bringing back a TAB favorite. Pastor Nathan Scoven Sr. will be with us all Sunday long, preaching the Word of God and helping us celebrate our senior pastor, Reverend Dr. Charles E. Goodman Jr., on Sunday, April 28th. We hope to see you there.
Everyone had a wonderful week. And for those of you that were able to get away for spring break, I hope you had a blast and squeezed in some rest. Now, I want you to lean in a little bit, beloved, because today we have Deacon Brown and Deacon Taylor, and they're going to share some insight about our beloved pastor.
You know, as I had served for 8 years in the leadership aspect of the ministry, including during the COVID, I got to really see pastor up front and pretty close. And I got to see what his platform was. And really, it included what we would find throughout the Bible. He really cared and served the widows, strangers, foreigners, the fatherless, children, and anyone who was in need. I got to see that. We had one member who, after the member passed, we were told the member had no family and no family was going to come to the funeral. And Pastor and I and folks that we needed to made the whole thing happen. And he said, it's not a problem. This is what we do. And when I saw that, I understood what it meant to be a senior pastor of this historic Tabernacle Baptist Church. And he exemplifies that.
I would say, just the relationship with Pastor Goodman, I just like he's a concerning pastor. He's always, you know, looking how we can go to the next level. I appreciate that from him. And his love and compassion for our senior saints, our the ladies of the church. He always wants to make sure they're recognized. Our men, he's always concerned about our men. Most of all, our youth. Every Sunday when Pastor Goodman preaches, if he's at TAB Main before he comes upstairs, or if he's at TAB West before he goes downstairs, he'll go and see the youth every time. You know, you got Pastor getting ready to preach the word, but he always has time to go see the youth, the kids, and they're so happy when he comes in there. And I just look at it, just brings me joy, and it's just amazing. You know, and I see that every time. So. Same thing at TAB West, you know, before he comes down, he goes sees the youth, and that's just truly, truly amazing when you know you got a word to preach, but you're going to have time to make sure you speak to our youth, knowing that's our future, and they see him, and they're just so happy to see him. So that truly, truly is just awesome to see that our pastor can just definitely take some time right before he preaches to see our youth.
Most of the congregants are not aware that as pastor is human, there are some Sundays where he's absolutely not the best physically. And he's like an MVP on your team. Only the players may know, his team players, but no one else knows because he gets out there and he comes. So I just recall following him at different services just to make sure he doesn't pass out. And he delivers a message like you can't believe. You just can't, unless you know, you won't know, because his main thing is to give that message. So I think that is one of the greatest things that's really not known mostly by most.
I will say this about Pastor Goodman on the golf course, and I value our friendship, you know, outside of the church walls. And I can say this, that when Pastor and I get on that golf course and we play together, we have a winning record that can't be beat. So I just say that to anybody. If you want to play some golf and you come out and play with Pastor Goodman and myself, you're going to be in trouble.
Thank you, Deacon Brown and Deacon Taylor, for sharing some of your heartfelt moments and memories about our pastor, as well as some funny moments. Now, to everyone within the congregation, I want you to continue to thank Pastor for 17 years and for him continuing to grind each and every Sunday. Thank you so much for worshiping with us here at Tabernacle Baptist Church, a local church making a global impact.
Oh, come on. Can we celebrate our pastor of 17 years? 17 years of pastoring people. And we definitely thank God for him and his diligence and his faithfulness coming in and week out, you know, making sure that we get a really great Rhema solid word. Again, can we just thank God for him? We'll be celebrating all month long his anniversary, and we thank God. On last week, we heard from our executive team, and on today, we heard from our deacons, and I agree with Deacon Brown and what he said. Pastor Goodman can be sick. He will come and make sure that we are going to get the best that God has given him for us. Again, 17 years. Can we just thank God for him one more time? Amen. Listen, as we have conditioned in our heart to give, we now will have a giving video from our pastor.
What's up, my beloved Tabernacle Baptist Church family? It's your pastor, PG, and once again, welcome to the most impactful place on the planet, Tabernacle Baptist Church. Listen, we're excited that you're with us. We're in the month of April. God has graced us, and I'm excited because this month we're celebrating 17 years that God has graced pastoring people to be together. So listen, in a few weeks, you're going to have a wonderful time of sharing, and so they're going to get all the events to come up. I hope that you come out and have fun with us. Because once again, this has been an incredible journey for 17 years. God has allowed us to progress together. And I'm looking forward to 17 more years of just continued kingdom impact through the Tabernacle Baptist Church. So listen, I need each and every one of you to know I absolutely love you and I can't wait to hang out with you. Listen, there's so much else is going on as we have our fellowships and as we're still getting through the congregational life. I know many of you just getting off for a spring break, and we're thankful for all of our kids who went on our college tour. I know they had an amazing time. And so once again, we're excited to be able to share and continue to do life and ministry together. That's what it's all about. So listen, as we come to this moment of our worship experience, it is also our time that we can be radically generous in what we share. We understand that fellowship and worship is so important, but also is stewardship. The Word of God reminds us that God loves a cheerful giver. That's right. This is the time of worship where if you don't smile any other time, you ought to be smiling during this time. So listen, let us begin to share in giving. You know the multiple ways that we give here at our church, from Givelify, Secure Give, Cash App. Remember to put what you're giving in the memo section. Also, you can use our app and our website. These are great platforms for us to continue to advance and grow the kingdom of God. Always got to give a shout out for those that mail their gifts in. And many of you who said this year, I am going to make sure that I prioritize God with my automated payments. And listen, if you are a guest with us today, whether it's in person or online, we appreciate every gift that you're sowing as well. And we thank you for believing and trusting in our ministry to once again impact our community. So listen, as we come to this moment of sharing, we understand that what we give does not come from our pockets, neither from bank accounts. Comes from my heart. And so I hope and pray that as you make a heart deposit into the kingdom, you understand how it moves God and helps to advance the kingdom. Let us pray. God, we love you. We thank you for another opportunity to give. God, you have blessed us with so much. And for that, we give you glory. So now take these gifts that we're sowing to make an investment in the kingdom, transform it so that lives will be helped and people will be saved and that the kingdom will be advanced. And so we're so grateful and thankful for that as well. We give you honor. We give you praise. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Well, listen, we get ready to set our hearts ready. Our worship and artist ministry is getting ready to set us with the next song that we will hear on today. But I'm excited. We're back in our UNITY series. That's right. We're continuing our journey through the book of Ephesians. I'm excited to share today. I hope it's going to be a blessing to you. And I'll see you in a few moments. God bless you.
There's no question of your greatness, no searching of your power. all the wonder of your glory. To you 40 years is but 1 hour. Your knowledge is all encompassing. To your wisdom there is no end. For you your truth is here always. You are he who was and is to come. Who is he that can number your days? You flung the sun to burning space. The ninth moon borrowed light from the day.
Forever and ever. For you alone are God. For you are God alone.
Imagine what 7 billion humans could accomplish if we loved and respected one another. If everyone was running their own race, but cheering for all others at the same time.
Now, unity, of course, is not that we all are the same or that we all do the same. Being united means that despite our differences, we are able to work as one.
And we need each other. In a real sense, we all part in an inescapable network of mutuality.
But you've got to stick together and strive side by side, not afraid of anything. You all become the temple of God.
This is the day the Lord has made, and we will rejoice and be glad in it. I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. Will you worship the Lord in prayer with me at this time as we ask God to grace our time of sharing? God, we thank you and we bless you, for you are awesome and incredible. We're amazed at your goodness, and now we appreciate the fact that in spite of us, you keep blessing us. So Lord, we pray now in this time that you would once again provide your strength and provide your glory. Thank you again for an opportunity to just gather in this space, whether it is in person or online. And we are so thankful that you continue to shower your blessings upon us. So now as we prepare our hearts to hear your word, that you would give us strength and clarity and understanding as I stand, allow me in this moment, God, to just preach the truth and let the truth set us free. And we believe by faith that the word will just do the work. We give you honor, we give you praise in Jesus' name, amen. Once again, this is the day the Lord has made, and we will rejoice and be glad in it. Look at somebody, if you're in person, say, neighbor, I'm just glad you're in church with me on today. And we celebrate our TAB Global family. Is anybody coming down for me? Amen. Once again, come on, let's bless God, let's bless God, let's bless God. We are excited for his goodness. We're continuing our series in the book of Ephesians. I invite your attention to turn with us to Ephesians chapter 3. And as we have been sharing and sojourning through this passage, I hope that we have learned especially what it means, the essence of what Paul is trying to convey, not just the work of God, but in the power of his church. And so we're going to look at this familiar passage, and it's actually my grandfather's favorite verse. So we'll share this with us today, Ephesians 3. Read verse 20 and 21. CSB reads this way. Now to him who is able to do above and beyond all that we ask or think, according to the power that works in us, to him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus to all generations forever and ever. Amen. As we continue our series on UNITY, I want to put this thought on this verse today, these verses today, put a praise right here. Lift those hands to heaven and say, Lord, speak. We need to hear. We give God glory and we give God praise. What an odd place to put a praise break. That is, in essence, what some perhaps would say as we're now been sojourning through this missive, this letter penned by Paul to the community there in the proximity of that city and town called Ephesus. Because for most of us, we would assume that this kind of praise, this kind of thinking, this kind of outward expression of love and gratitude towards God should come at the conclusion. However, my brothers and sisters, one of the most ballyhooed and most prominent doxologies that Paul prepares is what we see now lifted up here in the verses of Ephesians chapter 3, verses 20 and 21. It's important to note that it comes on the end and the conclusion of a prayer that Paul prepares as he is now sharing in what he is now declaring, not just from the enlightenment, but the enablement of God. As he shared in Ephesians chapter 3, verses 14 through 19, how we are strengthened by God, we are rooted by God, and we are filled by God. It seems to us, my brothers and sisters, that as he shares in this prayer, as he's interceding on behalf of those who will be listening, that somehow in this moment he feels the compulsion that he does not wait to the end of his missive, nor does he wait to the conclusion of the totality of his thought. He believes that this is the perfect time to give God praise. I raise that because I believe that Paul is onto something here, because there are perhaps some who will look at this doxology and perhaps say that Paul was out of line. He's breaking protocol. But any good doxology, any good praise moment and praise break does not need particular protocol. It does not need a certain time that it needs to fit in. I would offer that Paul gives us the template that whenever you think of how good God is, that one of the things that we ought to be able to do is to give God our praise. That's what we lift up here in these two verses, Ephesians 3, 20 and 21. It is one of the high doxologies that is provided by Paul. When everyone looks at how Paul structures his doxology, how he shares these words of praise, it lifts up some things because he uses doxologies I offer to us that as opportunities of praise and worship. He uses doxology to also signify certain transitions. Whenever he's trying to move from a thought to another thought, he will insert some doxologies, or he will use doxologies to kind of lift up good theology, because there is no good doxology without solid theology. In other words, Paul understands you need to know what you are shouting about. You need to know what you are praising God for. But I also raise this because this doxology, it reminds us that Paul is not just a preacher, nor is Paul just a professor. But what I appreciate through the words echoed here by Paul is that Paul is a praiser, that he's given this doxology out of his own personal devotion. He's sharing this doxology out of his own understanding of who God is. And I appreciate this out of all of my reading of Paul, as much as I appreciate what he adds to us from a theology standpoint, what he shares with us when it comes to Christian doctrine, how he really, in my opinion, begins to fortify and frame the walk that we are supposed to do in our relationship with God. What I really highlight here is the relationship Paul himself has with God. Because it's one thing to write about God, it's another thing to preach about God, it's one thing to sing about God. But the question I would raise today is, do you know the God that you're preaching about? Do you know the God that you're singing about? Do you know the God that you're serving? And that's what Paul shares in this moment. This doxology is the highlight, the culmination of the first part of the book of Ephesians. But he pauses in this moment to give this high praise to God. He shares it to us, and I would offer that it tells us that it doesn't matter where you are, it doesn't matter the time of the worship, it doesn't matter what station you're in, that every now and again when you can think, you ought to thank. That there's a part of us, my brothers and sisters, that lifts up. And that's what our passage, these two verses, highlights for us. He gives us the big truths of the gospel, the omniscience of God, the sovereignty of God. He highlights the glory of God, and it is jam-packed within these two verses. It is here where Paul concludes this prayer with praise. And I want to look at what Paul says in this moment. And I would suggest that we ought to pattern our praise life after Paul, because Paul sets the template of what it means to give God praise right now. Let me share, if you don't mind, let me try to unpack exactly what these verses says. And it is done in three ways. He highlights, first of all, when he talks about praise and talks about a praise break, notice first of all that he says that praise deserves to be right here based upon the indisputable persona of God. It's right there in verse 20. Now to him who is able. Let me try it again. The text says, now to him who is able. Let me try it a third time. Since I am a Baptist pastor of a Baptist church, now to him who is able. He starts with that adverb now, because what Paul is signifying is that he's already built an argument and a case. He's been talking the entirety of the first few chapters of Ephesians of about the adoption and selection of God, the redeeming factor of Christ Jesus, and the sealing of his Holy Spirit. He's been building this argument about all that God has done to benefit us, how he has utilized through the redemptive act of Christ to bring us together into the thing that he has titled the church. And so now, after praying that God was strengthened, after praying that God would root, after praying that God would feel, he then moves and transitions to now. He literally says that I done already painted you a good picture. I've told you everything that God has done up until this point. And so now is the right time. Now is the moment. Now signifies immediacy. Now speaks of us in our present moment, which means, my brothers and sisters, there is no time that now is not present, which means that every moment you're in, past, present, and future, it'd be present when you say now. That what he's building is this now, this moment that we should embrace, that there is no other greater immediacy than now. And the now he speaks of is now unto him. I thought I wouldn't have to work that hard today. I've been here 17 years. There would come a good time when you would learn how to just shout over scripture. But let me go and try it a little bit. Now unto him. Let me go ahead and just help you, because some of y'all perhaps have forgot who the him is that Paul is speaking of. He's talking about the sovereign, the omniscient God. Matter of fact, the term that is used in this moment is hearkening back to those who would hear this letter and be able to understand. He's talking about a God that has been intricately involved in the history of humankind. He said, that's the him that we're pausing for. That's the him that we're praising. He's not an absent entity, but he's an intimate kind of God. Now unto him. And the him, my brothers and sisters, that he says, that is able. Oh, help me, Holy Spirit. He says, now unto him that is able. He packs into the ableness of God, that he's not just an absent God that doesn't have capacity, but he's a God that is able. He's a God that is able. Somebody can testify that you know for yourself that God deserves praise because of his ableness. Matter of fact, for those who would hear this, could reckon this would be the same kind of tone and tenor that they would utilize to talk about how this Hebrew God was always involved in the delivering aspect of humanity, that when they were caught in their captivity, the able God brought them out of Egypt. When they were lost in the wilderness, that able God provided them cloud by day and fire by night. This able God, that whenever they shone into matches on the battlefield, that they were woefully overmatched. When they had God on their side, God always made the difference. This was important for Paul because he says, you need to know for yourself what God has already done. And I can already tell, I'm not sure how Tab Global is responding, but some of those folk in person seem a little sleepy when I talk about an able God. But let me just ask you, because I know that him getting them out of Egypt didn't move you, and I know that him providing in the wilderness didn't move you. I see all the work that Paul has been trying to build about the adopting of God, the redeeming of Christ, the sealing of the Holy Spirit. But this ought to be a moment where you don't have to just read the scripture, but you can read the testimony of your own life. Because you can testify yourself, he's an able God. You can go back in your life and see the times that God has shown up and shown out. Don't fool me today. I know there's some of us who perhaps don't even think about it, but you do realize an able God woke you up this morning. You do realize an able God that healed your body. You do realize an able God that opened this door and closed other door. Look at somebody and tell them, I'm grateful that he's an able God. He can do, he is able. I am grateful because when I look back over my life, he's shown up in every aspect. And if you can't shout over anything else, you ought to give God praise for his indisputable persona. There is no time that God has ceased being God, that he sits high and looks low, that even though he's over billions of people and over everything, he still has time to be there for you. I know my brother, sister, let me see if I can illustrate it this way. I never forget when I was in school, there were certain portions of the school day that to me almost seemed like they weren't that important. Before we could get into our lessons, here's what our teachers would do when I'm in the school I was growing up in. They would do something called take the roll. Because the whole idea of taking the roll was they needed to know what students were there and what students were not there. So the teacher, before the day would get started, they would start to call out different students' names as a way to take the roll. So they'll start calling out names. Alex. And if Alex was there, he would say, present. Mary. If Mary was there, they would say, present. William. If William was there, he would say, present. There'd be sometimes they'd call a student's name, and if that student wasn't there, you would hear nothing. Or someone would say, absent. So the teacher would know that they were not there. Charles, present. And that thing got to me, because as you look back over your own life and you start to take the role of different periods and seasons and circumstances and situations, can I ask you the question that when you took role of those moments, can I tell you that every single one of them, God was marked present? That there was never a time that God was absent. There was never a time that God was not there. Somebody can testify, he walks with me. And he talks with me. And somebody knows that that's reason why Paul says we ought to be willing to praise right here, because of the indisputable persona of God. But it's not just an indisputable persona that he lifts up in this doxology. But number two, he also says we can put a praise right here because of the incalculable power of God. Now unto him that is able, watch this, to do. Okay, there's sometimes certain words I wish I could squeeze through this. I'm sorry, y'all. Y'all got to just pray with the preacher today, because there's certain things that just scream to me to preach, because it's one thing to be able, which means potential and capacity. But it's another thing to be able to do. It moves from potential and capacity to follow through. You catch it. See, there's a lot of people that you know that are able, but they don't do nothing. But here, he says, the God we praise is not just able, he's also doing. So what does he do? Watch the text. He can do exceedingly, abundantly, more than you could ask or think. Literally, watch Paul, because once again, I told you, I have a literary crush on Paul, the way he's able to string together thoughts and ideas. Notice what he says, that while he's praying and writing and consuming and putting the context together, he said, let me tell you something, because I've been trying to explain his immeasurable works that he's been accomplishing. But he said, let me tell you something, that no matter what you think or say is too small, he can do more than you can ask or think. Okay, let me see if I can break down. He says, what comes out of your mouth is too small. And what you formulate in your mind is too small. Which tells me and you and I that there is no way we can outbid God in our prayers. Which raises the question today, how come you still praying small prayers? If you got a God that can do more than you ask and do more than you can think, why do you keep limiting that do God to do something in your life? I wish I had time. I get it. Because you don't know the superlatives that he uses in this passage. Matter of fact, he starts to add words that when one reads the Greek shouldn't be added. Paul, who literally should know better, is writing this passage and making up combinations of words that really honestly feels like overkill. Because notice what he talks about when he tries to exclaim the more. He says he can do exceedingly, abundantly, more than you can ask or think. Now, by themselves, they would seem sufficient. Who wouldn't shout over a more God? Who wouldn't shout over an abundant God? Who wouldn't shout over an exceeding God? But he don't just use them in isolation. He builds his argument to once again exclaim and try to paint a picture that what you think he can do, he can go beyond that. He can do all. But then he can go above all. But then he does more above all, but then abundantly more above all, and then exceedingly abundantly more all. I wish I had time. He says that here's your problem. You keep trying to limit God when the power of God is limitless. He can do exceedingly and abundantly more than you could ask or think. He can go beyond your beyond. He can go more than your more. He can go exceedingly over your exceedingly. I wish I had somebody that was excited as me to understand. I'm grateful that I got a God that can exceedingly abundantly more than we can ask or think. He says that's what you have access to. But this access is literally played out to Paul in the power that works in us. That word power, dunamis, is powerful because for Paul, he's been trying over the last couple of chapters to try to put some flesh to what power looks like and to show us how God's power has been manifested. If you go back to Ephesians chapter 1, you'll know that God's power was expressed in the raising of Jesus from the dead. That is an example of his exceedingly abundantly more power. But then in Ephesians chapter 2, when he talks about those who were far from God, the Gentiles, and those who were close to God, the Jews, how God brought them together and then put them in the mysterious thing we call the church through the work of Jesus Christ. He said that's another manifestation of the power of God. That if you want to know how powerful it is, look what he did through Jesus in Ephesians 1 and in the church in Ephesians 2. But then he says, here's the crazy thing, as he concludes his thought in Ephesians chapter 3, that if that's your frame of reference, that same power that raised Jesus, that same power that created the church, is the same power that's in work in us. Okay, I wish I had time. What he says is that the power or the grace of God that works for us, which is his saving grace, is the same power that's working in us, which is his sustaining grace. That same power he used to get Jesus out of the grave is the same power that's in you right now. The same power that he utilized to create this thing called the church is in you right now. You ain't got to go pick it up off the shelf. You ain't got to order it off Amazon. He says this power is already in you. Y'all going to have to help me preach today because I feel all right now. Because if someone would recognize how much power you got, if someone would recognize how much strength you got, if someone would recognize you right now, you ain't got to add nothing to it. You ain't got to take nothing away. You got enough power inside of you. Because the same power that got Jesus out the grave, Paul says, is the same power working in us.
I get it.
You don't appreciate the power because you don't utilize the power. And so it's hard to appreciate something that you don't utilize. I was born in 1979, so I would tell you that I'm not an 80s baby as much as I'm a 90s baby. A lot of my formation development was in the 90s. So I believe 90s is the best decade of all time. Had the best TV shows, had the best music. Argue with your mama. I'm telling you, 90s was the best. It even had the best TV commercials. And I never forget in the 90s, there was a TV commercial that was shown all across every channel by Energizer batteries. It was done through their mascot called the Energizer Bunny. Rather simple context. It would just have this little bunny playing this drum. It would do a pirouette in the middle of the screen and go off, and you would see this large battery pack in his back. And the motto of the Energizer Bunny ad was, it keeps going and going and going. So y'all, I ain't gonna front. I saw it, and because like you, I get kind of persuaded by commercials. I wanted to see if their thesis was true. So I had my grandfather take me to the store and I got me some Energizer batteries because the ad said it keeps going and going and going. So I bought me some batteries, had a little toy car, so I plugged it in. I will admit to you, the first couple days, that thing was running good. Zoom, zoom. I was just taking it up and down the street. But as I moved into week 2 and week 3, it wasn't as fervent. It was still pushing, but it wasn't as powerful. As I moved into week 4, 5, and 6, it was starting to extremely slow down. Until by the time I got to week 6 and 7, the car completely conked out. Now, I'm mad, y'all, because they advertise that it keep going and going and going. So my assumption based upon what it was advertising was that it would keep going and going and going. I got so mad, y'all, because I was that kid that I decided I want to write a letter to Energizer Batterman. I wanted them to include me in a class action suit because I felt like they were lying. How are you going to claim something got all this power? But after a while, it gets worn down. Well, let me tell you something. When Paul begins to advertise in Scripture and he talks about this power that works in us, here's the crazy thing about that power. It will never run out, which means you ain't got to stress about being the Energizer Bunny. But if you want to know a power that is sustaining, a power that never runs out, look at somebody and tell them, that's how I know, because it done kept me going through some rough periods. That's how I know, because since Christ got out of the grave, that power is still there. Here's the wonderful news, he says, is that the power that God gives us is incalculable. He can do exceedingly abundantly more than we can ask or think. We put a praise right here based upon the indisputable persona of God. We put a praise right here based upon the incalculable power of God. But then the last portion of our text, we put a praise right here based upon the inexhaustible prestige of God. Verse 21 said it this way, to him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus to all generations forever and ever. Amen. Okay, let me try it one more time. Y'all a little sleepy, and that's cool. Just getting off spring break, but check this out. He done already talked about that he's able to do exceedingly abundantly more than we can ask or think with the power that works in us. He then transitions to conclude, and because he's able to do this, now to him be glory. He says, this is the only trade God asks, is that since he's given us grace, we ought to give God some glory. That this glory alone belongs to God. He raises that up, my brother and sister. He says that this is why you and I should make sure that when we look about all the wonderful ways God has blessed us, all the wonderful ways God has made a way, all the wonderful ways God has shown up on our behalf, here's the least we can do is give him glory. But this glory that belongs to God, you can't share with no one else, because this glory is to God and to God alone. Those who've had followed me for years know that that's always my subscription. I always say soli Dei glory, which means to God alone be the glory, because God alone is deserving of our glory. Nobody else deserves the glory that goes to God. He says, watch this. So we give him glory, and it's manifested, watch this, in two places, in the church and in Christ. Let me try it again. He says, God deserves glory. And the two main places that glory should be manifested is in the church and in Christ. Let me try one more again. He says, now this glory that God deserves and has done and earned needs to be manifested in the church and in Christ. Okay. In the church, this out of all the doxologies, typically all the doxologies talk about the glory that is done to God through Christ. This is the only doxology that includes not just Christ, but the church. And he says the church ought to be the main place where glory is manifested towards God. That's his ultimate aim. He's been painting the picture of the last two chapters that this is God's work, God bringing together those ends and entities and individuals that seemingly would not be together. But he didn't just bring us together so that we can come together. He didn't just allow Jesus to die for the church so that we can just gather and come and be entertained. But there is a purpose in the church, and the church ought to do, if it don't do anything else, ought to bring glory to God. Y'all ain't gonna like me, but I gotta preach it anyhow. Because what Paul begins to understand is that you can't get caught up in your preferences, not understanding God's purposes. See, your preferences is predicated on what service you want to go to. Your preference is predicated on what title you're going to get. Your preference is predicated on who's singing and who's preaching. He said, you missed the whole power of the church, because the one thing the church ought to do is ought to bring glory to God. That if we don't do anything else good, we ought to bring glory to God. I know you're asking the question, how do we bring glory to God? We bring glory to God in the church through our works and how we serve humanity. We grow our glory to God through our witness, what we share with the world. And we show glory to God through our worship. That we don't just come to sit on our do-nothings, but we come because our God is worthy of glory. And I ought to have a few people under the sound of my voice that can testify. That's why I came to church. That's why I showed up, is because I believe God is deserving of the glory. That's why I came and I sat my, it may not be my seat, but I sat here anyhow, because I came to give God some glory. Lean over to somebody and tell them, the church ought to give God some glory. But ain't just in the church, but in Christ, because they too go hand in hand. Because there would be no church without the sacrifice of Jesus. And Jesus wouldn't have had to die if you and I didn't have to be redeemed. They go hand in hand, which means that in the church, I ought to glorify Christ. And when I glorify Christ, I'm glorifying him in the church. Because church is not predicated on walls and buildings. Church is predicated on the ecclesia of the called out that God has fashioned us to be. Look at somebody and tell them, I've been saved to give them glory. You weren't saved because you were so good. You were saved because God said, I'm saving you so that you can open your mouth and give God some glory and some praise. Lean over to somebody, tell them, you ain't gonna beat me giving them glory. Because when I think about how good he's been and how awesome he's been in my life, I can't help but to tell him thank you. I can't help but to give him glory. And watch what Paul said. Paul said, this ain't a temporary thing. That you don't just give him glory on Sunday. You don't just give him glory for a week. You don't give him glory for a month. You don't give him glory for a year. The Bible says forever and ever. Look at somebody and tell them that's forever. That's a long time. That there should never be a time that we're not giving God some glory. There should never be a moment we're not giving God glory. Now unto him who's giving glory in the church and in Christ Jesus forever, ever. Watch this. And he conclude by saying, amen. Oh, shucks, I wish I had time. Amen. You do know what amen means, right? It means let it be. Amen means it is so, which means everything I prayed for, everything I praised for, that when I put an amen on it, that when I say amen, I'm saying God's gonna do it. When I say amen, I'm giving God permission to do what only God can do. I got to get out of here, but my soul done got happy. Grab someone by the hand and shake that hand and say, neighbor, I don't know what you've been praying for. And I don't know what you've been praising for. I don't know what you got on your mind or what you need to speak out of your mouth. But neighbor, I'm about to touch and agree for whatever you prayed for, amen. Whatever you asked for, amen. Whatever you're thinking about, amen. Do I got anybody here that said amen over my life? Amen over my family? Amen over my church? Amen over my dream, amen, over my helm. Look at somebody and shout amen. Ah, amen. Amen. Woo, amen. Amen. Everyone standing now unto him that is able to do exceedingly and abundantly
more than you can ask or think. Through the power that works in us, now to him be the glory in the church and in Christ Jesus forever and ever. Praise goes right. Look at somebody, tell them right here, right here. Tell them you ain't gotta stop clapping, right here, right here. There's never an odd time for us to give him doxology. And good doxology is undergirded through good theology. Which means Paul saying, I need you to shout, but I need you to know what you're shouting about. Yeah. There's nothing worse than an ignorant worshiper. But it's even probably more than that. It's nothing worse than a smart person who continues to spectate. Because the more you know about them, the more you realize how deserving God is of glory. I don't even have those crazy conversations with people anymore. It don't take all that. It may not take all that for you. But you don't know like I know what the Lord has done for me. To our TAB Global family, come on, let's celebrate them. We thank you, and I hope and pray that God's word was a blessing for you. You see the multiple ways of connection there on our screen. The heart of this church is extended to you. And even in this moment of digital sanctuary, we're appreciative of how God connects us through the airwaves, through on demand. I hope and pray that you understand that God desires relationship through the stewardship of how we worship, because it all belongs to God. We're praying for you, TAB Global family, and we say this all the time, because we've been blessed, we're going to be a blessing. We'll see you soon. God bless you.
Yo, what's up, family? We hope you enjoyed that incredible worship experience, and we pray that something was said in this Unity series that will bless you, that will inspire you, that will most of all impact you and encourage you wherever you are at right now. You know, it's a blessing. It is an amazing blessing to be in multiple locations, to be able to worship our one God and worship together. In this moment, more than ever do we need unity. We are in a contentious year, politically, socially, spiritually, and we need each other more than ever. There's a term by the name of synergy. Synergy means that we're able to accomplish more together with one another than we are apart. Of course, we're amazing and inspiring by ourselves, but just imagine what we could be as the Church of Jesus Christ in this moment right now. We need the best of you, so get in the game, and we're excited about the place that you are going to continue to play here. Make sure you go online, check out all the ways you can get involved. We want to make sure that we put all our hands and our feet together to move this year. All right. Hope y'all have a wonderful week. Take care.